today is November 1st. And I usually get excited every year about this time because we're moving closer and closer to Thanksgiving. And Thanksgiving is my favorite holiday. I prefer Thanksgiving over all of the other holidays because of Thanksgiving's emphasis on thankfulness and family. But this year, that emphasis on thankfulness and family sits uneasily in front of the other things that are going on in our nation. Things like the pandemic, the economic hardships that have been affecting so many people that have come about because of the pandemic, the apocalyptic-like wildfires that are ravaging the West Coast, or the nationwide protests, or the racial and political tensions and violence that are going on in our country right now. All of those things happening simultaneously can make it difficult for us to feel thankful in this time of the year. And while our situation might seem unusual and worrisome to us, we find in the Bible a different picture of life that offers to us reasons to be thankful even in the time that we're living in. So this month, over the next 4 weeks, we're going to take some time to look at four different reasons for our thankfulness as we work our way towards the Thanksgiving holiday. And we're going to begin this morning by considering one of those reasons that we find in the Bible for the thankfulness that is to define us as God's people. We're going to spend some time this morning thinking about the thankfulness that we feel, that we are thankful because Jesus frees us. Before we begin to do that, however, let's take a moment and pray together. Father, we're glad that we can gather as a family this morning. Even though we're not all together in the auditorium, we are still thankful that we can gather. We're thankful that we have the freedoms, the privileges, the opportunities to gather like this. And we pray that you help us to be mindful of all the things that are available to us in this time in our country and in our church family. We pray that you help us to be good stewards of all the things that you've given to us, to use them in ways that bring honor to you. We pray this morning that you'll help us through our worship to be reminded of your goodness and your sovereignty and about the salvation that Jesus offers to us. We ask all this through his name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, open to the book of Galatians. We're going to explore the freedom that Jesus offers to us this morning by looking at the book of Galatians. Because in the book of Galatians, Paul spends some time describing the freedom that Jesus offers to people. And that focus on freedom that's a part of Paul's message to the Christians in Galatia was part of his response to the situation that motivated his writing. In Galatians chapter 1, we find at the very beginning of his letter, Paul stating the issue motivating his writing. Galatians chapter 1, verse 6, Paul wrote, "I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ." There were people, Paul was told, coming into the churches in the Roman district of Galatia, trying to proselytize Gentile Christians to a Judaized version of Christianity. And Paul saw that as a threat that undermined the message of Jesus, the good news of Jesus. And so he wrote to address the seriousness of that situation. Now, to help us understand a little bit about the seriousness of this issue, we need to have a little bit of background to understand the situation the Gentile churches would have found themselves in. The Jews enjoyed certain special exemptions from the Roman government. Exemptions that Rome required of other people but did not require from the Jewish people. They were, for example, allowed by the Roman government to be exempted from the Roman national religion. They were not required to participate in Rome's religions. They were not, for example, required to pray to Rome. They could instead pray for Rome. The Jews were also exempted from mandatory service in Roman armies. They were exempted from the national customs that were part of the Roman Empire. And when we read about those exemptions that Rome offered to Jews, to us it might sound like a good thing. They were given some freedoms, and in a sense, it was a good thing. But for the majority of people in the Roman world, it did not seem like a good thing. It singled the Jewish people out as different, as aloof, and most importantly, they saw the Jewish people as a population that, because of their refusal to participate in Rome's customs, in Rome's religion, in Rome's institutions, endangered the peace and the safety of the Roman Empire in their world. And so the Jewish people lived in a tense environment in the first century. They were trying to navigate the expectations of the Roman world, the hostility of the culture they lived in, while maintaining what they believed were their religious and cultural obligations to God. And it's in that environment that we find Christians whose heritage had its origins in the Jewish faith and Jewish practices. And like the Jews, Christians also did not join in the Roman religious institutions, but neither did they follow Jewish laws or customs. And Christians' behavior therefore created a potential problem between the Roman Empire and the Jewish people, because Rome didn't distinguish Christians and Jews. They saw them as part of one large cultural group. But it would have appeared to anybody who paid any attention that the Christians were trying to take advantage of the exemptions that the Roman government gave to the Jewish people without following the requirements for those exemptions. And so part of the motivation that would have been behind these teachers trying to convince the Gentile Christians to follow Jewish customs would have been an effort to avoid the scrutiny of Rome, because that scrutiny would have brought danger that would have caused danger for their lives, for their well-being, for their security in their world. It was a way of creating peace by demanding certain exceptions, certain requirements from these Gentile Christians to the Jewish faith. And Paul responded to that very strongly. He begins by saying that these people were teaching a different gospel that distorted the good news about Jesus. And so Paul spends some time reminding the Gentile Christians about the good news of Jesus, why it's good news, and why they shouldn't walk away from what had been given to them in regard to Jesus. And he introduced his message by reminding his readers the good news about Jesus deserved their complete attention, and that they shouldn't be concerned about the messages or the approval of anyone who taught anything different. And Paul, as he begins by talking about these people who are giving a distorted gospel, mentioned his own behavior in Galatians chapter 1 and verse 10. He, after talking about these individuals, said, "Am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." And so he then moves to talk about the good news of Jesus and why it deserves their complete focus. And he begins by reminding them that the good news about Jesus included a new relationship with God that gave them new identities. In Galatians chapter 2, beginning in verse 16, he talks about this new relationship and these new identities by contrasting the expectation of these teachers that were coming in and giving this distorted gospel to the Christians in Galatia with the message they'd received about Jesus. And if you remember, these people coming in were saying to the Galatian Christians, in addition to Jesus, you have to obey these things from the law of Moses. Things like circumcision, things like certain feast days and practices. And so Paul contrasts that in chapter 2 and verse 16. He says, "We know that a person is not justified by works of the law." And when he talks about being justified, he's talking about being brought into a right relationship with God. He said that right relationship with God does not happen through obedience to certain works that were commanded under the law of Moses. Rather, he said, it comes through faith in Jesus Christ. And this faith in Jesus Christ not only ushers one into a new and right relationship with God, it also gives to them a new identity. Paul talks about that new identity that comes in that right relationship a little bit later in Galatians chapter 2 in verse 20, as he talks about his own life. There he wrote, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. He had a new identity, no longer Paul, he said, but now he possessed Jesus' identity that came because of what Jesus did for him by bringing him into a right relationship with God. And he told the Galatian Christians this message about Jesus, the good news of a restored relationship with God and a new identity, if they sought to follow these teachers who are giving a distorted gospel, then it would undermine the value of Jesus' love-motivated sacrifice. As Paul continues these thoughts in verse 21, he said, I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. So he talks about their new relationship with God that Jesus gives to them, their new identity that comes in that right relationship with God. And he goes on to talk about how that new identity that comes through that right relationship makes them sons of Abraham. He talks about how Abraham believed the promises that God made to him in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 6. The promises that God made to him regarding a child, an offspring, through whom God would bring blessings to Abraham and through Abraham to the whole world. He mentions that Abraham believed those promises and God counted it to him as righteousness. A little bit later in Galatians 3 and verse 17, there we find Paul talking about that promise and how that promise of Abraham's offspring, Paul says, didn't merely refer to Abraham's family, but he said it referred to Christ in verse 16 and 17. And so in Paul's line of reasoning, he says, and we get down to the end of chapter 3, verse 29, but also back in verse 7, if we believe in Jesus, then he says, you're like Abraham, who also believed in Jesus by believing in the promise that God made to him. And so Paul says, we become sons of Abraham when we have faith in Jesus. But he makes the point that being a son of Abraham did not obligate these Gentile Christians to obey the law of Moses. And he spends some time talking about the purpose and the function of the law of Moses in this section in Galatians chapter 3. But part of the reason he says here that they are not obligated to follow the law of Moses, like these teachers were telling them, was because Jesus set them free from the law. In Galatians chapter 3, he writes in verse 24 and verse 25 that the law's purpose was to lead people to Jesus. But now that Jesus has come, now that faith has come, he says we are no longer under a guardian. We're no longer under that law. And the freedom that Jesus brings, the freedom that he talks about from the law of Moses, for example, was central to Paul's message to the Galatian Christians. Look, for example, in chapter 5 and verse 1. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Paul's message was Jesus. The message of Jesus is good news. The word gospel means good news. The message of Jesus is good news. It gives you a right relationship with God. It gives you a new identity. And it does all that by freeing you from things like the demands of the law of Moses. But in the context of Galatians, he offers at least three things that he mentions that Jesus freed his audience from. In the first place, it freed them from those individuals who are demanding false things from them in matters of religion. They were not obligated to listen to those teachers that he mentions in Galatians chapter 1. They were freed from the demands of those people. He also comments in Galatians how Jesus freed them from the curse of the law. This is why being freed from the law was so important. In Deuteronomy 28, there's a lengthy section beginning verse 15 down through verse 68 in which God, through Moses, lays out all of the curses that attended the law of Moses. But in Galatians, Paul told his audience in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13 that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. He stands in our place. He has freed us from the curse of the law. But Jesus, in this book of Galatians, Paul wrote, also freed people from hostile yet impotent non-gods. He writes in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 3 that in the same way, talking to the Galatian Christians about their identity before they encountered Jesus, in the same way, we were children enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. He picks this idea up again down in verse 8. When you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. But now that you've come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world? The freedom that Jesus gave to them freed them from all those false ideas and myths that were a part of the world within which they lived. The freedom that Jesus brought, Paul said, is very important. It's part of the good news of Jesus. But Paul's message to the Galatian Christians that Jesus has freed them was not a message that they're freed from to be whatever or whoever they want, but rather that Jesus freed them from those things so they could go to something. The message of Jesus, Paul wrote in Galatians 5, verse 13, is that they were called to freedom so that through love they could serve one another. The freedom that Jesus offers us frees us to serve people. And we need to think about this message that's central in Paul's mind to the freedom that Jesus brings. Because understanding that focus on service that characterizes Jesus' freedom begins by recognizing the freedom that Jesus brings is built on his identity. And if we think about Jesus' identity, we find, for example, in Matthew chapter 20, verse 20 through 28, that Jesus was very clear. His mission was not to come to be served, but to serve. And when we become Christians, as Paul mentions in Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 and 28, we take on Jesus' identity. Those who have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. We clothe ourselves in his identity. And because we take on his identity, he said, we're not defined by the identities we have in our world. We are no longer Jews or Gentiles. We are no longer slave nor free. We are no longer male nor female. We become people who bear Jesus' identity. And as he mentions, Jesus' identity is one defined by service. And because we take on Jesus' identity, Jesus' servant identity, there are, Paul wrote, certain expectations for our character. We have to cultivate a character that supports that kind of servant's attitude. In Galatians chapter 5, he describes some of the characteristics that are central to that character transformation. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit, he says, and he lists a series of characteristics that are to define us, that we are to chase after. We are to be people defined by love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. This is Paul's message to the Galatian Christians, that they were free, that Jesus set them free from the demands of these teachers that were coming in and troubling them, set them free from the religious demands of the world within which they lived, set them free from the demands of the law of Moses. It was a message central to what Paul wanted the Galatian Christians to understand, a freedom that was at the heart of the new identities that Jesus gave to them and the new right relationship that he gave them with God. Now, what does that mean for us? We are not Gentile Christians living in the first century Roman world. We're not troubled by Jewish teachers trying to convince us to follow Jewish practices, as were the Galatians. What does this message about the freedom that Jesus brings mean for us? A few applications as we consider Paul's message to the Galatian Christians. In the first place, it's a reminder that we must guard against anyone who tells us we need anything other than Jesus. It's easy to say that. In practice, it's also easy to make accommodations to our world and to our culture and to our preferences and somehow get to the point where we see them as being as essential as Jesus himself. We only need Jesus. And when anything begins to creep up on the place that Jesus is to hold, we should stand up and resist those things. We only need Jesus. Secondly, our identities, our sense of self-worth, depend on no one, not even on ourselves. Rather, they depend entirely on Jesus. We live in a culture that talks a lot about being a self-made person. Through hard work, through diligence, through effort, one can rise in their station in life and make something of themselves. And there's a sense in which that's true. But we understand that who we are and what we accomplish does not depend on us. We understand our identity, our most meaningful identity, is not defined by a career. It's not defined by prestige or distinctions in this world. It's not defined by pedigree or money or looks. We understand our best and truest identity comes from Jesus, the identity that he gives to us when we choose to follow him, an identity that allows us to have that right relationship with God, an identity that allows us to become like him and enables us to serve others. That means our freedom is not based on the laws of our country. Our freedom is not based on any politician. Our freedom is not based on anything we have in this life. Our freedom is based entirely on Jesus' sovereign identity. Because all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him, we can be somebody in this world. Because Jesus rules and he gives to us, when we submit to him, a new and exalted identity. And that defines who we are in this world. That freedom is a cause for celebration in our lives. But that means we need to develop an elevated view of life. When we're surrounded by things like the coronavirus and political and racial tensions and protests and economic hardships and wildfires, when those kinds of things are going on in our world around us, we need to be reminded there's a larger view of life than merely the one that we can see going on around us. We need to be reminded that Jesus remains in control and he has a goal towards which he's working that's larger than ourselves, that's larger than our nation. And when we submit and participate in his goals, then he secures for us a future that's better than what we have right now, no matter how good what we have right now might be. Our obedience to Jesus means that our relationships are no longer driven by conflict to secure our wants and needs, because we have entrusted our lives and our well-being to his rule. I don't have to fight to protect myself because Jesus promises to watch over me when I submit to his will. If you remember in Matthew 6, when we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, he will make sure we have what we need. But we have to, first of all, commit to seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness. And when that happens, I am not obligated to fight to protect myself and my interests. Jesus promises to do those things on my behalf for me. And finally, because we locate our freedom in Jesus, we are then free to serve one another without fear, because I don't have to worry about what may or may not happen to me. Jesus promises secure me, not only in this life, but most especially in the life after this life. Jesus' freedom is the truest possible freedom, but it's a different way of thinking about freedom than we tend to think about freedom. It's one that requires a realignment of our thinking to match the things that God tells us in the Bible really do explain the world in the way the world works. It requires us to reset our values, to resort our priorities, to see things the way that God designed them to be seen and designed them to work. But it is the gospel, the good news. It gives to us something of tremendous value. And when we see it and when we grab a hold of it, we have a freedom that makes us truly free. A freedom that paradoxically expresses itself through our service to one another. And because of what Jesus offers, we can be people who are thankful, who rejoice, regardless of what might be going on around us in our world. So this month, let's be thankful people because of the freedom that Jesus gives to us. And let's express that freedom through our commitment to serving one another in the same ways that Jesus serves. This morning, whether you're here in the auditorium or down the hall in the fellowship room, you have an opportunity to petition Jesus' forgiveness and Jesus' help. You also have an opportunity to draw on the strength and the encouragement of our church family. In his wisdom, God has given to us a family of people who share our focus on Jesus and who, because of also our shared experiences in sin and failure, can be sympathetic and help provide loving accountability as we all work towards being the people that Jesus calls us to be. Or if you've not made the decision to give your life to Jesus' control, to submit to his will so you can become a truly free person, I would encourage you to make that decision this morning. Whatever your need might be, you have a chance right now to come forward and let it be known as we stand together and as we sing.